You know, sometimes I look at the moon and I realize just how little I actually know about it. Like, what is it made of and how did it form? Of course, the best way to solve this problem would be to just go to the moon, but I don't know anyone willing to send me there just yet, so I did the next best thing. Earlier this year, I visited NASA to go inside the most secure laboratory on Earth, the Lunar Sample Lab, where they keep all of the moon rocks.
All right, welcome. You're in the Apollo Sample Laboratory. So this is the lab where we process all the moon rocks. So this is the largest collection of moon rocks on display anywhere in the world. There's literally nowhere you could stand and see more of the moon up close than you are right now.
The rocks in that room are worth around $12 billion, and I want to know how they got them back, how they store and protect them, and most of all, what did we learn by bringing the moon down to Earth? Thanks to KiwiCo for sponsoring today's video. Back in the 60s and 70s, the US and Soviet Union were in a race to put man on the moon, and while that was the goal, we knew surprisingly little about our destination. We had some good theories about how the craters formed, and we knew it didn't have an atmosphere, but that was really about it. With the Apollo missions aiming to put boots on the ground, there was a huge opportunity to bring back pristine moon rocks for us to study. But of course, some people were thinking about the worst case scenario. What if some alien microbes hitchhiked a ride back to Earth on board a moon rock, and then our planet became contaminated? And so NASA designed some very specific protocols for how to handle the moon rocks once they got there.
There's really careful protocols in place called planetary protection. In planetary protection, you worry about it in both directions. This is not the original Apollo laboratory. The original Apollo laboratory was built next door as a quarantine facility to keep the Apollo samples just in case. And they didn't think there was life on the moon, but you'd only get to be wrong about bringing back.
And you want to be sure.
You want to be sure.
In 1969, Apollo 11 touched down on the lunar surface. Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin took the first steps on the moon. They only spent 2 hours and 31 minutes on their moonwalk, and during that time, they collected the first moon rocks and lunar soil samples. And then it was time to come home. They boarded their lunar module, flew back to Earth, and touched down in the ocean. The three astronauts and their moon rocks went straight into quarantine for 21 days back in Houston, where I visited. NASA even made the crew sign a customs form when they arrived in Hawaii after splashdown. They declared moon rocks and moon dust as their baggage, and it even said that they departed the moon and arrived in Honolulu.
So, like, the first step when they landed in the ocean was get the astronauts out. The second step was to get the samples out. So they grabbed the spacecraft, they got it back to the aircraft carrier, and then they immediately took the samples out.
Are they bagged up on board?
They are. And so, but on board, they were collected on the moon in Teflon bags mostly, and they were just sort of rolled up almost like a cookie or a chip thing and sealed. And then some of them were put in what we call rock boxes, which were hard metal boxes that had like multiple sets of vacuum seals on it.
When they arrived in the quarantine facility, these technicians that were wearing these big protective suits had to open the rock samples, and they originally tried to keep them in these huge vacuum chambers, basically just mimicking the environment of the moon. They tested the samples on animals to see if they were dangerous or filled with alien microbes. Mice were injected with lunar soil. Moon dust was fed to cockroaches, and they even mixed some into fish tanks. Fortunately, nothing alien grew, and none of the animals even got sick. In fact, the cockroaches actually thrived on their moon dust diet. The samples were cleared to be studied, and they soon realized that using these huge vacuum chambers was extremely hard, and so they switched to storing the samples in nitrogen-filled glove boxes, and they still do that today.
So what we have here is the different processing cabinets where we work on the Apollo samples from the different missions. So from 1969 to 1972, there were 6 missions that landed on the moon, and they collected 382 kilograms of rocks. Half the mass of the Apollo samples came back on Apollo 16 and 17. We've actually been pretty careful with how we've used it. So of the original mass, we still have about 83% left that we haven't studied. We store about 70% of the samples here,
yeah.
And then we have a secret offsite location in White Sands. It's where at White Sands is a secret. The fact they're at White Sands is not a secret, but we store about 15% there.
Yeah.
And then the other 15% are either with scientists, have been consumed as part of the analytical process. They're in museums, and so it's like 70, 15, 15.
Okay, so they got all the moon rocks back, and it was finally time to start doing some actual science. Weirdly, we didn't know a lot of the simple stuff about the moon at this point. When you look at the moon, you can see these bright white areas and these large dark patches. But why does it look like that? Before Apollo, we pointed telescopes at the moon and theorized about what those dark patches might be. The first to do it was Galileo. After he perfected his telescope, he pointed it towards the cosmos for the first time in history. Of course, starting with the moon. He noticed craters, grooves, and mountains, and at the time, people thought the moon was a perfectly smooth surface, unlike the Earth. And he too asked the question, what are those dark patches and those bright highlands? I actually even have his original sketch of the moon tattooed on my arm. Before we actually went to the moon, we were pretty sure that the dark areas were basalts, basically molten rock that had cooled really quickly. But they didn't know what all of that white stuff was. And so when the Apollo astronauts got up there and brought back some rock samples, scientists made a huge discovery. The dark rocks were basalt, as expected, and they had all of these little bubbles from the volcanic gases, but the bright white rocks found in the lunar highlands were actually made of a very special kind of rock called anorthosite. Basically, no one expected this, and it changed everything. Anorthosite is made of a material that is less dense than normal magma, which means just like ice in water, it floats to the top. This gave a scientist, John Wood, a brilliant idea. What if the moon used to just be one massive ball of magma? A magma ocean world. This would explain why the moon appears to be covered in this white crust of anorthosite everywhere. If it were just one big ocean of magma, then the white rocks would float to the top, and over time, as the moon cools down, settle into a nice shining crust 50 kilometers deep. Then, over billions of years, the moon would get bombarded with meteor impacts, and lava would continue to erupt through the crust, creating these huge craters and basins that Galileo observed when he looked at the moon. They wanted confirmation of this idea, so they needed to age date one of these white rocks. They trained the Apollo 15 astronauts to specifically look for white rocks, and sure enough, they brought home a 260 gram huge chunk of anorthosite, the famous Genesis rock. They dated these rocks to be 4.4 billion years old, just as old as the Earth. A primordial crust, and just what you would expect if the magma ocean idea was correct. Okay, just before we take a look inside NASA's top secret moon vault, I want to show you something. I've partnered with KiwiCo for this video, and they've sent over two awesome crates to try out. If you haven't heard of KiwiCo, they create hands-on science, engineering, and art projects for kids of all ages. I've always said that hands-on learning is absolutely key to building a deep understanding in science, and kits like these make it so fun and engaging. They sent me the Astronaut Starter Kit and a mechanical globe from their Eureka Crate line. The Astronaut Kit lets you build your own model of the solar system, complete with a rocket launcher and rockets you actually get to launch, plus a full magazine and poster packed with fun facts about space. It's perfect for any of the little aspiring astronauts in your life. With this Eureka crate for ages 12 plus, you get to engineer a full-on mechanical globe. Gears, mechanisms, and all. So here's the deal. If you're ready to spark a passion for STEM and hands-on discovery in your kids, or you're just looking for an unforgettable holiday gift, I genuinely do believe that you will love KiwiCo. If you use my code AstroKobi, you'll get 50% off your first monthly crate at kiwico.com/AstroKobi. It's a great way to support the channel, and trust me, you'll have a blast learning right alongside your kids. Now let's go look at some moon rocks. Okay, so this left one huge question. How do you melt the entire moon into a magma ocean? Something had to provide an enormous amount of heat really fast. A truly colossal planetary-sized ball of heat. The answer? Well, what if we just smash the Earth with another planet? The giant impact hypothesis.
So we think the moon formed through a giant impact, that something hit the early Earth, maybe the size of Mars, and the debris from that impact became our moon.
Yes.
That was so energetic that it melted the whole moon, probably. And so rather than a solid moon, we had a molten moon or a magma ocean.
Scientists started to seriously look at this idea, and all of the evidence seemed to agree. Using the rocks from Apollo, we finally knew how the moon was formed. In the late stages of Earth's formation, a Mars-sized protoplanet named Theia smashed into our baby Earth. The collision immediately vaporized and melted huge amounts of rock. The Earth becomes surrounded by this ring of magma, and thanks to gravity, it starts to coalesce. Our magma moon is born. This is when the bright crust of anorthosite starts to float to the surface. And that's how the moon formed, something we only figured out thanks to the moon rocks brought back by Apollo. Now, just before NASA was going to let me go into the top secret vault, I just had to ask if there were any funny or interesting stories of how they brought the moon rocks back. And they didn't disappoint.
That one also has a fun story because that's what we call seatbelt rock. It has nothing to do with the geology. That's what happens when astronauts lie to mission control. On that mission, they had the rover, so they had more mobility than oxygen. So they had strict rules about how far they could drive from the lander and still walk back if the rover broke down. It's very basic. And so they were behind schedule, and the astronaut in charge of the mission, Dave Scott, saw that sample and he wanted it. And he knew that if he asked to stop and get it for geology, he'd be told no. And so what he did instead is say that his seatbelt had come undone, and could he stop and fix it? Because his partner in crime there, Jim Irwin, the other astronaut who had the camera on him, kind of pointed the camera over here, just randomly. And then he started talking. And for 90 seconds, he talked about just stuff, like the craters he saw and the rocks.
Just for no reason.
Just to distract NASA. And in the meantime, Dave Scott was collecting that sample. And they didn't tell anyone until they came back. And all of a sudden, they were like, why do we have an extra rock? And they're like, oh, funny story. So those are stories I'm probably not supposed to tell, but whatever.
I also had to ask about astronauts supposedly being allergic to moon dust, since I'd read about that before.
They got lunar hay fever, and I think it was just breathing.
How fine it is.
Yeah, it's like breathing in a fine powder. I mean, it's not good for you. Apollo samples are like got shards of glass in it, and like long term, it would be terrible to breathe in. For a few days, it's not that worse than being out in a forest fire or being near a volcanic eruption.
And of course, I need to know what my guide's favorite moon rock was.
My personal favorite sample, there's one from Apollo 17 called 76535. We don't have it out. It's the only troctolite that came back from the moon. And it's actually one of the only pretty rocks that came back from the moon. As much as I love the moon rocks, they are all gray or white or brown or sort of like, they're not super colorful and pretty.
Now, finally, it was time to go into the most secure room at NASA. The vault where the moon rocks are stored. The goal of the vault is to keep the samples safe forever, no matter what is going on outside of those doors.
It is built to withstand a Category 4 hurricane, so like 160 mile an hour winds.
As we went to go open the bank vault door, they asked if I wanted to do the honors. It would be rude not to.
So, do you want to open it?
Maybe.
Oh,
that would be good. If possible, that would be good.
All right. So wow. You're going to turn the main wheel counterclockwise. It won't go as far as you think.
Okay.
Yeah, go for it. There you go. Now set your foot and kind of use your whole body weight to just sort of give it a tug.
Cool.
Oh. It's really open. Hurry up. Again.
So you put your, there it goes. See. Yeah. I mean, nine tons takes a bit to,
to get it moving. Yeah. But then once it's moving, yeah.
Pretty good. It's pretty good hinges.
It's very smooth.
Oh, yeah. So now you're in the Apollo sample vault.
Wow.
So this is the cleanest part of the lab. And so the reason we don't start back here is because while this is really cool, because this is where 70% of the moon rocks are on Earth, you can't actually see any of the moon rocks back here, really, because they're all hidden away. And so just like out in the main lab, we just store them in these, nitrogen purged stainless steel glove boxes. And it's all about inventory. So originally, the 382 kilograms of rock were 2,200 individually numbered samples. I now have 128,500 samples that have unique numbers from the moon that we have to track where each and every one of them is.
The air inside the vault is ultra-filtered to be extremely clean, and it's even kept at a higher air pressure than outside, so any leaks push air out instead of sucking it in. The rocks are kept in these airtight glove boxes filled with extremely pure nitrogen gas.
So this is the Apollo 15 cabinet, one of them, and so everything in here is from the Apollo 15 mission. And so in order to keep the samples safe, we store them in these stainless steel bins, and most of them are sealed up because they've been inventoried. And so these are basically tamper proof. And so we know whether someone has been in here if they're not supposed to. Here are the different types of containers we use. And so all of the samples get three types of containers around them. So in this case, you've got one stainless steel container with a Teflon top and then two Teflon bags. So it's triply contained.
Yes.
They only touch the moon rocks with very specific materials. Stainless steel, aluminium, or Teflon. Nothing else, ever. Now, just before I left Johnson Space Center, I had to ask how things might change as we enter the Artemis era. If you didn't know, NASA is going back to the moon, and it's happening very soon. And of course, I'll be making videos all about it, so you better be subscribed. Now, as early as next April, NASA plans to launch the Artemis II mission, sending four astronauts on a journey around the moon and home to test their new rocket and Orion spacecraft, as they look to set up a permanent moon base, with astronauts working on the moon similar to how they work on the ISS. I wanted to know what new materials they are hoping to find on the moon, since this time, instead of going to the face of the moon we can see, they are heading to the lunar South Pole.
The two biggest things at the South Pole that are probably going to be different are, you know, you've got the volatiles at the South Pole. Now, we're not landing where we think the high concentrations of volatiles are, but even landing nearby that will give us a good idea of what the background is down there versus at the equator, and we'll start to like build the picture of how much water and other volatiles there are at the South Pole. So that's the most basic thing.
The lunar South Pole is a completely different kind of environment to where the Apollo missions landed. Sunlight grazes across the surface, and some craters are buried in permanent shadows, craters of eternal night. Scientists are pretty sure that we will find frozen water ice and other volatiles in these cold craters, something Apollo never got to actually look for. This ice is like a time capsule just waiting to be studied. It has been sat there in those craters, frozen and unchanged for billions of years, perfectly preserved. Imagine what we might find by studying it. We are still not entirely sure how water and organic compounds arrived here on Earth and on the moon. This could help us solve that problem. There's honestly still so much we don't know about the moon. Like, why does the near side and far side of the moon look so different? One thing is for sure though. Over the next decade, we will continue to unravel the mystery of our place in the universe by establishing a permanent presence on the moon. And I can't wait to see what they find.